Again, you just tuned into the Zo What Morning Show. I'm Zo Williams. I play the role of the philosopher. We have the doctor here, author of Just Listen, great book, How to Break Through to Anyone, Dr. Mark Goulston. Welcome. Welcome back, man. How you doing?
I'm just listening. I'm glad to be here. Hope people call in, ask us, get stuff for free that I'd have to charge outside of this.
Hysterical. Get stuff for free. And you know what? And I think that's the beauty and the value of the show. We talk about how this is the show that listens. And the fact that Dr. Mark Goulston is here sharing his expertise, hey, come get some. It's free right now. 323-965-1600. That's what we're doing. I think we have a caller online, too. It could be Geoff Brown. Hey, Geoff, what up?
Yo.
Where you at? You in the shower? What's going on?
No, I'm clearing out my house.
Just sounded really airy, really breezy.
Oh, it's breezy? Hold on. How's that? AC now.
Well, put the top up on your car.
Well, you know, I wish I was in my car. I'm at the house, and I don't know, Doc, what you know about Altadena, but my man Zoe does. Somehow, this city is closer to the surface of the sun than any other city in Southern California.
Well, yeah, you know the mountains, and it's very picturesque.
Yeah, it's 136 degrees, though. I don't need the pictures. I need cool.
Well, hey. Listen, I just set up the show. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you can participate. We're going to jump right into our crack news media correspondent, our intern
Chuck.
Slash producer. They call her Chuck Doe, but her name is Mercedes Bryant. Mercedes, who are we talking about today? Give us the first story.
Okay, today we're going to talk about Chris Brown. He has a new tattoo. It's a skeleton that looks like a battered woman, so everyone's going crazy. They're like, oh, he has a tattoo that represents Rihanna. What does this mean? But really, they don't know that his birthday is on Cinco de Mayo, and skeletons that represents for that day, the Day of the Dead, which
right.
That's like a thing in the culture.
The Day of Death, right?
Mm-hmm. So we should take a vote. Is it a celebration of Day of the Dead, or is it Rihanna Revisited?
I think that dead heifer on his neck was a lot like Rihanna. Let me just say that.
But listen, though, Geoff, I don't think he's that irresponsible. I think he's learned his lesson. And when you're in the media like that, you get beat up for any little misconception or perception of the public based off of what you've already done.
Absolutely.
So. Automatically, they say, oh, God, he's got a tattooed picture of Rihanna on his neck after he beat her up.
Well, I think he has the dubious distinction of being the heir. First off, let's get this out of the way. He is the heir apparent to Michael Jackson.
Okay? Oh, no, I'm going to disagree.
I can't. You name me somebody else that is that talented in that many places. I can't think of Chris Brown can act. He can sing his ass off. He can dance his ass off. But he's also Ike Turner. Okay, so he's basically Ike Jackson.
He's Ike Jackson.
Ike
Jackson.
Listen, the poetess is talking about your cell phone. She said, "Are you on the cell phone or a payphone? Whichever one is not working."
I'm on a landline.
You on the, well, damn.
Should we call him out? Should we call it to him, or should we call him back?
Ike Jackson. Let me just say this,
though. Sounds racist. Ike Jackson.
Let me just say this. I disagree 100%. I don't think he's anywhere near the singer that Michael Jackson is. Performer.
Woo!
I don't think he's anywhere near that. I don't think he's anywhere near the talent.
Oh, wow.
I just don't. I'm sorry.
Okay.
You know, but with that said, the dude has amassed a tremendous amount of success and fortune. And I just think it's hard for him because it's almost like he's got to ask the public's permission before he does something. It's almost like he can't live his life without being misconstrued in some way.
Well, he's in a petri dish of idiots. That's another problem.
He's where?
He's in a petri dish of idiots.
God, you have a turn of phrase, Geoff. I'll tell you that. I think that heat has gone to your head and made you better.
Okay. It's being around you, Doc. It's being around you. I think that's rubbed off on me.
No, but I think the kid has learned his lesson, you know?
Me too.
I think he has learned his lesson, and I think he deserves to live his life. And that's one thing in American culture, that's like one of the most difficult scarlet letters to take off, you know, because it's almost like there is no redemption for a guy who's, you know, battered someone or abused his woman or something like that, even if they get back together. which is the case and in a lot of ways. You look at Rihanna and Chris Brown, they see each other still. They're still kissing. They're still seen in public, hanging out and all of these things. Obviously, they've gotten past it. But a lot of the perception of people let it go.
I don't think he's learned his lesson until you know what he does when he's really angry.
There you go.
I mean, in fact, when I one of my advice to couples before they get engaged, and we're going to talk about should they get engaged in the second segment, is get into, we had this, I think, a week or two ago, get into some arguments just to see the other person at their worst, because you're going to find out their worst later. And a lot of times people are in good behavior at the beginning of a relationship, and then you get to know them, and it's amazing. You can really love someone and really not like them.
Absolutely.
And really not know them.
Yeah, there's that.
They know what they show. You know what they show.
No, you know how they make you feel. You don't know them, and you like the way they make you feel, and then when they start doing something that you don't like, the way it feels... And a lot of times you marry yourself. I mean, you know, you get involved we're looking for things to make us feel better about ourselves. And a lot of times we don't even know the other person. Years ago, I saw this amazingly beautiful woman. And actually, her ex-husband said, I'm going to pay you to see her because she's perfect. And I said, oh, she can't be that perfect. She came in. She was perfect. And I thought, wow, this is kind of neat that she's perfect. And then what she was talking about is she says, I am in this world for men to show off. Nobody wants to know what I think, if I think. Mm. I'm here to make men look better to other men.
Wow.
And she said, look, she said, it's a real problem because you feel used all the time. And what am I going to do, throw acid on my face? I mean, it's... But it's terrible. I mean, there was a saying.
Wow.
There was a saying about Marilyn Monroe. Actually, blogged about it in the Huffington Post. That when everybody loves you, but nobody knows you, you die of loneliness.
Wow.
Wow.
Why is that? And I'm gonna pose this question to Geoff and the doc. Why is it that men covet the beautiful woman more than they covet the substantive woman? When I say substantive, I mean, you know, there's a spiritual quality, there's an emotional quality, there's a nurturing quality, there's an intellectual quality. Why is the beautiful woman, does she trump all of that?
I think men are kind of adrenaline junkies. They love power, they like winning, and there's something about, look at the hot chick that I got, I've won. And I think it's interesting, I think a lot of men would rather win than have other people respect them.
They won't. Ooh. I got to stop talking to you, dude. I'm going to be over here crying. That's wild.
You crying?
I said, I'm going to be over here crying. I keep talking to Doc. That's heavy.
Well, how did that... Gee, Geoff, you always push back at me. You must be having a bad day that you're actually agreeing with me.
No, I agree with you. I agree with you a lot more than you think. This thing about beautiful... I think the thing with beauty and women, as opposed to depth when it comes to women for men, I think that has to do a lot more with raw physical nature. The best peacock, lion with the biggest mane, it's a physical thing that you want the finest woman that your game, your money, your looks will get you. What happens is that we're not just animals. So now you have to start dealing with this fine heifer. And a lot of times,
Geoff,
you have been told that they were fine their whole lives are freaking horrible.
But Geoff, let me say this.
I want you two to weigh in with your collective huge IQ. I mean, I'm the lightweight in this crew, I'll tell you.
Not really. Sorry. I'm just not.
Well, that's because I...
Well, that's what's so dope is ain't no lightweights. We, you know, ain't none of us, ain't nobody, we in the Tour de France and ain't nobody on a tricycle. We all getting it.
Okay.
So what do you think of this? I think that human nature doesn't exist. The only thing that exists is animal nature and humans' ability to not give in to it.
Wow. No. No, there's something to that.
Wow.
We talk about this And that's, we're talking about that limbic system of the brain, that portion of the brain, the old reptilian portion of the brain, and then you talk about the new developing portion of the brain, which is the frontal lobe, and that can be hijacked by the old brain. It's like, I heard somebody say, we're just animals struggling not to hurt each other.
I got
to
tell you this story. A story.
That's fun.
Here's a story about Jesus and St. Tom. And St. Tom took over for St. Peter at the pearly gates. And he thought he was in over his pay grade. And so he says to Jesus, what do I do? And Jesus said, I don't know. Ask them about me. They seem to have me on their mind a lot of the time. So ask them what they think of me. And so a few hours later, Jesus comes back and says, so, Tom, how's it going? Tom said, hey, I think I got this thing nailed. Well, no offense, Jesus.
No pun intended.
No pun intended. And Jesus says, well, who'd you see? And he said, well, the first person I saw was this beautiful woman. I mean, she was just gorgeous and lovely and flowing white hair. And I said, so who is Jesus? And she said, Jesus is beauty. Jesus is love. Jesus is fairness. And Jesus scratched his head and said, so what'd you do with her? Tom said, sent her through. And then Jesus said, who else did you see? And Tom said, well, I saw this guy. He was kind of like Geppetto in Pinocchio, just this terrific guy. And I asked him, tell me about Jesus. And Jesus says, so what'd he say? Tom said, well, the guy said Jesus is just, he's strong, he's fair. He champions justice. And Jesus looked kind of upset by this. He said, really? Did you see anyone else? And Tom said, I saw one other person, but I don't want to talk to you about that person. And he said, no, tell me about that person. And he said, well, this person, you know, had kind of a gold tooth. I mean, he looked like, you know, some real, you know, crazy kind of, you know, caricature. And Jesus said, yeah, tell me about him. And Tom seemed uncomfortable. And Tom said, well, he said that Jesus was vindictive. Jesus was jealous. Jesus was angry. Jesus was petty. So Jesus said to Tom, what'd you do with him? Tom said, oh, send him away. And then Jesus smiled at Tom with this loving smile. And he said, Tom, that third person saw me exactly the way I am.
Wow.
But what he failed to see is my daily struggle to not be that way.
Wow. And that's the human condition.
Mm-hmm.
That's the human condition. And I think for the people who can manage that, versus those who can't, what ultimately happens, and this is back at Chris Brown, it's difficult to gain redemption after you've lost it. You have to demonstrate and demonstrate and demonstrate that you're not that person anymore. But people will still have that stigma. It's like the poetess said earlier about Michael Jackson. All you have to do is be accused of pedophilia. Guilty, innocent, it doesn't matter. The association now, through the lens of the public, you know, we're looking at you sideways, even if you're innocent. I mean, you look at the Michael Jackson story. He paid $20 million. To most people, you're guilty because you paid somebody off. But for him, he's saying, I just don't want any association with this thing. Take this money, get out of here if that's what you want. Because even if it comes out, I know the perception is going to be I did it.
Maybe the question is, does celebrity have a responsibility?
Ah, great.
Because, you know, your fans, you get all that money from fans loving you and whatever, but is there a responsibility you have? And, you know, you can't have your cake and eat it too.
It's kind of a fine line, though. The responsibility part is a fine line because I still get to be me. Do I have to ask the public's permission before I get this tattoo on my neck? Geoff, what do you think?
Well, I think you got to get to a point. I think you got to get to this level of kiss my ass-ism that you really can function without the scrutiny or within the scrutiny and without the approval of anybody. And there are certain celebrities that have the strength to pull that off. Jack Nicholson, Anthony Hopkins,
right,
the Ving Rhames, these kind of cats that they really, really, you can see it, their genetic makeup, they sweat. I don't give a shit what you think.
Right. And you know what's funny, though? Every time you talk, every time you speak, the poet just puts up this big Kool-Aid grin picture of you so the fans can see your
That's
face.
Hilarious.
It's just this big-ass picture of you cheesing.
I wish they really could see me with this dirty ass T-shirt leaned over in the front of my new, well, it's not new to me, obviously, since I'm repairing the water pump, of my 87 Blazer truck that I'm going to put an LS1 in and go Corvette hunting. That's for the car heads out there. That's, yeah.
All right, so look, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take another quick break. We're going to take our first break, but when we come back, we're going to continue with our round robin of stories. And don't forget, call in 323-965-1600. I think I have a special guest coming up. It's going to surprise everybody. But call us and let us know. The second hour, we're going to be talking about the relevance of monogamy. Should we just do away with it altogether? You know what I mean? You know, we just going to really get into it. So we'll be back at 2.2. Holla at you in a minute. Zo what? Morning. Let's do it.
Hello?
Ladies and gentlemen, Zometheus Rising, a.k.a. the voice of reason, the philosopher, Zo Diggity in the building with my good friends, Geoff Brown, the comedian.
Yeah.
And Dr. Mark Goulston. On deck, of course, with our lovely and attractive and intelligent, but illegal as of yet, young correspondent intern, Mercedes Bryant. We're in the building right now, Zometheus, the Zo What Show, having a great time. We got more news stories to cover in this round robin of current events. Mercedes, what do we have going on right now? If you want to chime in and talk to us about anything, 323-965-1600. What is it?
Okay, so we have Republican candidate Mitt Romney. He was...
Wait a minute. Belay this story. I think we have a caller. Caller, okay. Speak up. Hello.
What's up, Zoe? How y'all doing, man?
We're good. Who is this?
This is Casey Shakur from Oakland, California.
What's happening, man? What's the word, my friend?
Man, you know, blessed, man. How y'all doing?
All right. We hanging in there. Just about to get into this other story. Did you have something you wanted to expound on?
Yeah, I actually did, brother. I just wanted to add my two cents on the whole Mitt Romney political process.
Oh, yeah. We're about to cover that, but go ahead.
Yeah, go in.
You know, I'm conflicted because, you know, as much as I want to believe into the whole your vote counts and this and that, it's really like people don't know about the Electoral College. They don't know about how there's over 150,000 lobbyists in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like I try to explain to these brothers, it don't matter what color Obama really is. If someone's foot is on your neck, it's still on your neck if it's black or white. You know what I'm saying?
Wow. Go ahead, well, bro. Could you repeat that?
No, that's good stuff. Because a lot of people don't understand what he's talking about. Stay on with us, brother, because we want you to go into that, and we're going to cover this other story. People don't understand. This is a war on class. This isn't color. This isn't, like, and class is connected to commerce, and commerce is connected to capitalism. And a lot of people don't understand. This is the engine that drives this whole thing.
Thank you.
You know, but again, politics, patriotism is really the political form of religion, because it whips people up into a fervor. And it causes them to think unclearly. They're not thinking logically. They're not thinking deductively. They're thinking passionately. Nothing strokes the passions of a country, of a nation, more than patriotism and their chosen religion. Somebody disagree with me, call me right now, 333-965-1600. Go deeper into what you were saying, caller.
Yeah, it's political theater, basically. It's the haves versus the have-nots. They portray, like, well, we're for you, the Democrats. You know, we're going to give you these things. And then the Republicans are the big boogeyman. But what you don't understand is that Wall Street and big business owns both of these people.
Thank you.
Now, the Democrats might throw us a bones, i.e. health care, food stamps, and so on and so on. But with the whole Citizens United, which was a ruling in the Supreme Court allowing corporations to donate unlimited funds, I truly believe with that ruling, America was killed. That's when it was sold. It was no... It's, you know, it's like the Wizard of Oz. They pull the curtain. It's like, we ain't playing with you no more.
Right. So you're saying, like, you're saying honor, integrity, and truth has been purchased by, you know, agendas of giant corporations and people who can basically come in and usurp constitutional rights and things of that nature.
Well, absolutely. Well, let's be real. Okay, I'm a black man, okay? And no disrespect, I'm not playing no card or nothing like that, but I have a different history here. In school, when they taught me George Washington was a great man and Lincoln was a great man and these guys wrote the Constitution were the greatest forward thinkers, I told my teachers, no, they were not. This was less than 250 years ago. These people held people in bondage and in slavery. I don't care what you say. That was not the thing at the time. It's not 10,000 years ago. These people were murderers and rapists.
Wow.
Okay?
Wow. If you agree or disagree with the caller, please call us and let us know. Chime in the conversation. If you agree, if you have a strong disagreement, a logical disagreement, call us and let us know. 323-965-1600. Caller, appreciate you, man.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves.
Oh, he's gone. Thank he you. Was just about to take off again. Yeah. But Mark, talk to us about it. You know, a lot of black people, we disgruntled with the government. We don't trust government. We won't even go to court. We'll get a failure to appear quick.
And keep it moving. Okay. In the words of my Uncle James, you don't need a driver's license to drive. You need a driver's license if you get pulled over.
Uncle James is going to send us all to jail. Mark, talk to us.
Now, I was just wondering, how often do you think someone donates money to tell people, I'm giving you money to do what you think is the right thing, versus I'm giving you money to do what I want you to do?
I'd say it's about 99 to 1.
Right.
Yeah, 99. I'm giving you money, and so if I give you money, I own you, and I expect something in response. I'm just not giving you money to do the right thing if that goes against what I want.
Wow.
Don't you? I mean, I think that's kind of the elephant in the room. I think we're going to get into Mitt Romney. I think Mitt Romney is more out of touch with the 1% than he is with the 99%.
Oh, absolutely.
Because I don't think, I think down deep. I think he's a decent person, but what he doesn't realize is that the rich and the wealthy, there's all kinds of studies that show they just don't care. They just don't care about the have-nots. And so I think he's out of touch thinking, well, we're going to help them become more wealthy and we're going to have the trickle-down effect. I think he's out of touch with the majority of the wealthy who... research shows that they just don't care.
That's where we disagree.
But you know, yeah, I think because I'm with you, Jeff, on this one. But let's let Mercedes set up the story, and then Jeff, you can come and lay the hammer down.
All right,
Mercedes,
yeah.
What is the leading story today in America right now? Talk to us about it.
So Mitt Romney, he's Republican candidate for presidency. And on Monday night, he was in a room with, I guess, his supporters.
His people.
And he was videotaped. He didn't know he was being videotaped, of
course.
That's
when the truth come out.
That's when the president uses his power of the CIA and NSA to snoop on his opponent. Go deeper.
Wait, now, was he the one who was topless? Am I mixing up stories here?
No, that's Kate Middleton.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's Europe.
Don't nobody want to see Mitt's titties.
Especially those nipple rings. Go on.
Oh, damn.
So he was caught talking about some candid things from what he thinks about Obama supporters versus his supporters.
And was it how he really feels?
It's how he really feels.
Go deeper.
He basically, this is his statement. He said there are 47% of people who are with him, talking about Obama, who are dependent on the government, who believe it's the government's responsibility to take care of them. I'll never convince them they should take care of personal responsibility for themselves. That is an entitlement, and the government should give it to them.
So he's saying poor people feel like it's the government's responsibility to take care of them, and they have a sense of entitlement,
right?
Almost like, I'm poor, do something about it, government.
Right, and then he says, and they will vote for this president no matter what. My job is not to worry about those people.
Those people.
But he's right.
Is he?
He's right.
How is he right? Go deeper.
He's right. Okay, first off, he's right in saying that poor people look at rich people like the enemy. It's us and them for the most part, even though we want to be them. Okay, he's right there. Two, he's right that ain't no... Put it this way. Like I told the dude on the plane, he asked me, are you voting for Obama because he's black? I said, no, that's racist and wrong. I'm voting for Obama because I'm black. So he's right there. Nobody poor and black gives a shit about Mitt Romney. He can forget that vote. He is also right that the poor think that the government owes them something. And you know what? They're right, too. The government does owe a group of poor people that they refuse to pay to look at. Reparations. I don't give a shit if everybody poor that got some money went out and bought Escalades like Dave Chappelle said he was going to. Everyday money. And ain't nobody said shit about that.
Right, right.
Well, how do you tell a person who can't help themselves from one that won't help themselves?
Right.
What? Say that again?
I said, that's easy. You need to come to one of my family picnics.
But can we say collectively right now that the disenfranchised people, right, in America, could we put a percentile on those who want to help themselves and those who refuse to help themselves? I know there's a movie that just came out, right? And that comedy is called The Campaign. And if you see it with Will Ferrell and Galifianakis, although it's a comedy, there is some level of truth in the writing when they talk about the lobbyist behind a particular candidate. They talk about voter fraud. Let me go deeper into this. It is said that the Ku Klux Klan, a Masonic order, was established by Albert Pike, right?
Uh-oh.
A Mason, right? If you study the Ku Klux Klan's doctrine, they have a book called The Quran. Kloran, The Quran, right? Sounds like the Quran, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it's a secret society, and I'll go even deeper into that if you want. But the Quran, if you read it, there is a section in it Because remember, the original purpose for setting up the Ku Klux Klan was to scare newly freed African Americans to not vote. There is a section in the Quran that breaks it down, that deals with observing their voter habits, preventing them from going out and voting. Now, maybe racism isn't as overt as it was in the day of the Klan, but remember, the power of the Klan at one time reached all the way to the American Senate. You had senators and governors that were straight up grand wizards sitting and presiding over people. So maybe it's not that overt today, but the same practices are in place. You go back to 2004, right? You go back and look at that second presidency that Bush got. And Florida was the pivotal situation. And right. Then after that, Ohio was the pivotal state. And there was voter fraud rampant. Florida, what was the lady's name? I forgot her name. She wasn't the governor, but her name was Catherine something. Somebody, one of the listeners will tell us, 323-965-1600. She basically decided who the president was going to be because right. They refused to do another recount. You know, the dangling chads and the absentee votes. Come on, they're in the business of rigging these things. Well, that's what I believe.
I think what's being missed.
Oh, wait, Geoff. We got a caller. Who's online for us right now? Ladies and gentlemen, we have a caller on the deck. Who's here for the Zo What Morning Show? Talk to me, man. Hello?
Hello, are you there, caller?
My name is...
Caller? Peace. Who is this?
Who working the board in there?
No. You talking, Geoff. Let me hear. They're speaking right now. What is it? Hello?
Yeah, look. Afrika Bambaataa.
Oh, Afrika. Legendary hip hop godfather, Afrika Bambaataa in the building. Welcome to the Zo What Morning Show. What up, Bam?
Hotep. Peace.
Hotep. Oh, my goodness. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're anywhere near your phone, please call us at 323-965-1600. Now, check this out. We got Bambaataa, the godfather of hip-hop, on right now. And it's important. We have to divert our conversation, even though I'm sure Bam could actually speak to what we're talking about, voter fraud, disenfranchisement of minorities and people that don't have the resources to fight this big system. This is breaking news.
Okay, damn, but what breaking news means is damn what we were talking about or doing.
Right, but let me do this. Last week, we were talking about hip-hop, and we were talking about a beef that was going on between Lupe Fiasco, which is widely considered, you know, a contemporary conscious rapper who's trying to make a difference by using his platform and music. And we were talking about a beef between him and a young kid who has a formidable platform as well, 17-year-old Chief Keef, right, out of Chicago. And we're talking about hip-hop being used to glorify gangs and violence and corruption, misogyny, homophilia, all kind of stuff is using this powerful culture to convey a message of death and lack and scarcity. This is the guy, Afrika Bambaataa, who used an emerging culture to convert gang members into hip hoppers, into breakdancers, and now hip hop is being used to do the reverse. I mean, you got Lil Wayne claiming blood, you got Baby claiming blood, you got Game claiming blood, you got Snoop claiming Crip. My question is, Bam, how do we use the power of this culture, man, to bring back or to start a movement that you started in the late 70s? How do we get that to happen, man?
Well, the first thing we got to look at, what's causing the problem? And if you check the history from what we started back in the early days to what it is now, something has snuck in the culture and took it over. And we call it the Luciferian conspiracy.
What does that mean?
Uh-oh.
Meaning that there's others who may not think like we used to think, like when we was coming up knowing about civil rights, human rights, fighting for quote unquote black power or human power, and has snuck in our culture, which first, when we came out, it was all about the party. Then we added that fifth element, the knowledge, and we started using hip hop to bring about unity in the street, peace, unity, love, and having fun, and letting our brothers and see how to start showing some love for self and love for the community and love for your elders.
Mm.
So something has snuck in our culture, and not just the culture of hip-hop, in so-called black people culture. And when I say black, I'm talking about my Latino brothers and sisters, too.
Mm.
That has caused something to change and detour the movement of the people who was following the Malcolm X's, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the Nation of Islam, the Ansarul Allah community from Dr. York, the Black Panther Party, and so many more, Angela Davis and all this stuff, Maryam Makeba and the Free South Africa movement. Something has caused something, you know, when they say like the Jefferson, we moving on up.
Mm-hmm.
Something has caused the friction of losing who we were and what was our struggles of the 60s that slowed down in the 70s because we thought we was moving on up like the Jefferson, and all the stuff is back in our face in the next millennium, 2000.
Can you share some moments when you realized that you looked out and you said, we can all do and be better than this, you know, when it was all in that violent mode, because it seems like it's shifted now and people don't care about doing and being better, that people care about getting more of their piece of the action. But you have a few stories you can share when it really dawned on you and then you really devoted yourself to that?
Well, the story I got to share is that many of our brothers and sisters, and I'm saying all of them, had lost the touch in getting back in the community and speaking to the young brothers and sisters. See, back then, we respect each other's mama. Your mama was my mama, your papa was my papa.
Yeah.
You
were
gonna cuss in front of your mother or be somebody else's mother who we respect, we can put a hand to our butt or be taking us to our parents and say, you know, this one's talking out of hand in front of us.
Mm.
And we had the Big Brother program when the men would come in and speak to the so-called gangs. So when we had the gangs going crazy in the streets, we had people like the Nation of Islam coming to visit us. We had people from the Ansarul Allah community coming to visit us. We had the Black Panther Party who would come and sit down and speak with us. You had many of these great people. You had what's his name that did all of the black exploitation movies? Always had the white woman.
Black exploitation movies?
You had the I Can movement in the West Coast where he was speaking to the gangs. You got to ask, what happened to all this? What happened to all of the elders coming back in the streets and teaching what happened? How many of us have forgotten and we forget, you go back, whether you watch Roots, whether it was real or not, or the knowing our story, our history, our mystery.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Speaking to the brothers, speaking to our so-called Latino brothers and sisters to stop this friction to I'm brown and you black, like if you ain't the same people, which you try to run from your African side, which is your Moreno. When you hear the songs like Big Pun saying Boricua, Moreno, well, when you're saying Boricua, you still say Moreno because you still come from the ancestry of the Moors.
Right, right, right.
So we're not teaching no more of our story, what happened. You're not teaching it. It's just almost 40 years ago. And the same problems that they had back then in the 60s, is back in the face of the people now. Yes, you made some strides, you made some movements, but then everybody has got too calm and relaxed, and that's why they're taking back everything. What you thought was your community that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad put so much to say, get up, black man and woman, and build for self, and do for self, and Marcus Garvey and all them, we turn our backs on all these great people who came to teach us, Noble Drew Ali. All these greats who came to teach us, we turned our backs on them, and now we are getting the repercussion for turning our backs on what we were supposed to be getting up to do for self by building your own hospital, your own schools, your own stores, and this and that. and you're coming back into a slave for just begging.
So Bam, are you telling me that, because this is what I recognize. I recognize today we are, I mean, technology is doubling and tripling and quadrupling like every 2 weeks. You know, our technology gets more and more advanced. But I feel like just listening to you right now, the content that should be flowing through these technological streams of delivering information, the technology is superficial. It's not deep. You know, it's like we got access to all the information in the world, but it's almost like the smartphone. Cool Mo D told me this. He said the smartphone is smarter than the person using it. It's like we're dumb, but we have a smartphone. It's like we're not using it for its power, what it could actually deliver to us. The content we want is Pop Sugar. The content we want is who is Rihanna dating. The content we want is who got money, or who got the flyest clothes, or who got the new Jordans or the new LeBrons. We want superficiality, but we have the means to get meaningful information. But these young kids, it seems like, and this is why I won't bang on Chief Keef, because regardless of what he's talking about now, he's only 17 years old and he has a position of power. My question to Bam is, how do we get this young generation who's isolated and insulated through technology, how do we get them the information that says you matter more than what you accumulate? You matter more than, you know, what you can get physically, you know, materially. How? Because it seems to me that they don't really care about culture. They don't really care about knowledge. They'll say, you know, there's too many words, or that's too much information. I'd rather, you know, listen to a record, or I'd rather, you know, watch a video of somebody fighting or something silly. I just don't understand. There's a disconnect for the youth. And what you're talking about, how do we reconnect them to the power of what hip hop can do spiritually, culturally? How do we connect them to that?
The only way to still connect is, like I said, you must first look at what is the root of the problem, who is putting money to make sure the problem stays the same, and getting the elders, all the big brothers and sisters who know, who are consciousness, back in the streets, in the community. I don't care if they say, I don't want to hear about that, I'm this and that, I'm a gangster, I'm a pimp player, I'm making all this money. You still speak to them, and you still try to communicate to the brothers and sisters to stop being degenerates or degrading in the neighborhood and be warriors for their community and their people. And it's only going to take a human speaking to a human.
Wow.
And we have all this technology, which many of our people helped to make it, but many of our people don't even know that half of them help to invent half of this stuff, and some of them don't really care. And like I said, we ain't going to be able to save everybody, but we got to get back in the street to keep speaking to our people.
Do you have any?
We can't take the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan to keep going after all these years, to keep the only one to keep that could get out there and keep doing to stop the killing, when you have so many other leaders and young leaders in the community that many should be speaking to the youth.
Wow.
Got to speak to some of the rappers that need to be on conventions and hall meetings, town hall meetings, with brothers and sisters. What's the brother from Chicago name?
Chief Keef.
Chief Keef, I want you to come to this meeting, brother, because I need to speak to you on a one-to-one basis, or I need to speak to you on a community basis.
Let's reiterate that, though.
Not trying to degrade them right in their face or in a big audience and going back and forth arguing. No, speak to your brother and sister behind closed door. Talk to them on the situation. Let them see. Brother, check this DVD out on what happened to your people back this amount of time of this. And you got some, they might feel it. You got some that say, I'm all about the Benjamins. And those are the ones you're just going to have to push on the side and like they used to do in South Africa, not destroy and kill them, but you might have to put them out to the community.
That's kind of like...
Until we put laws and discipline back in our community, there's always going to be people who could come in with money.
Wow.
And alter what needs to be done.
Are you saying that the black community...
How to build our own schools, gymnasium, our own centers, own hospitals and all that, then you defeated the purpose of what you're here on earth to could do for your people.
Bam, are you saying, are
but
you, Bam, but.
Turning over in the grave.
Afrika Bambaataa, are you telling us that the black community, the only way we're going to turn it around is if we take that price? It seems like you're saying we have a price on our head. Like somebody can always come in and offer us something that we're willing to sell a piece of ourself for.
I'm saying that just look at history. We had the great Motown who groomed groups, who made them know that they were gods and goddesses, to where they sold it. And Isaac Brothers sold Cheap Neck and other companies like that. And now you got the people who want to be the B word with attitudes, or the NWAs or stuff like that. We ain't saying that we don't need some of that, because sometimes some of them is hitting on another part of the community that needs to be told. But we need our elders and our older brothers and sisters in the street, and even the young ones that are conscious, to get back in the community and speak to the people.
Wow.
Ain't nothing going to be done if you don't speak to your people. If you're scared of your people, I'm scared of the Crips, I'm scared of the Bloods, I'm scared of the Latin Kings and all this stuff and that, and you're scared of your people, then you will never do nothing to change the situation that you're in.
Wow.
If you don't take the fear that you don't know, the only one I fear is the Creator, whether you call Allah, Jehovah, Yahweh, Elohim, Jah, or the many other names, and go back and be the time, like when there was no computers, no internet, none of that, what Elijah, Noble Drew Ali, Marcus Garvey, and all of them had succeeded more than with all these computers put together. They had succeeded more getting our people together, and when now we got all this information out here, and we still can't get our people together in this millennium. Something's wrong.
Wow.
And we got to look at what went wrong back then, so we can know what's happening now, so we can know where we're going for the future.
So,
otherwise, we're going to be wiped out.
So let me do this really quickly. Afrika Bambaataa, where can people who want to connect with you directly, where can they find you? Do you have a website? Do you have any email situation where they could reach out to you and share their thoughts and ideas with you, as you have done so eloquently here?
Well, we have the ZuluNation.com, and we have email Zulus@ZuluNation.com. We also have the Universal Zulu Comedic Moors, which you can also send emails to Zulu staff at earthlink.net. Then we have many brothers and sisters, you know, around the world who are also trying to do things in their different communities of the Universal Zulu Nation, as well as many of the other groups who's out there that's still been struggling and trying to do things for the people, and which money has been playing a big role. We also got to teach our young brothers and sisters who are killing over this dollar bill that's not even real money.
Woo!
If it's not backed by gold and silver, you fighting over toilet paper that could be reprinted over and over in a thousand and make you believe that it's real money.
Wow.
And teach the value of what happened with gold and silver.
Wow. Man, this is so heavy. Let me just say this, man. I really appreciate you taking out the time to call us. The show is honored to have you here. I appreciate it. We got to take a quick break. But, brother, you can call back anytime you want to, man. And hey, we'll open up the floor for you to share your vast and immense amount of knowledge. We appreciate it. And I honestly hope that Chief Keef and Lupe Fiasco reach out to you, man, so you can broker some type of peace or some type of understanding between the two brothers, because they stand on polar opposite ends of this powerful culture known as hip hop. And if you can bring them together in any way, in any shape or form, I urge them to reach out to you now. And once again, thanks again for taking out the time to call in. Afrika Bambaataa, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. We got to take a quick break. I'll be back.
Party people, can y'all get funky?
So what? Morning show. Hey, we just had Afrika Bambaataa in the building. Do you understand how huge that is?
Can you talk about what you talked about in the break, who he was and what he did?
Oh, my God. People don't understand, man. This dude used the culture of hip-hop to stop gang violence in New York.
Yeah.
He basically did it single-handedly.
He was the Thomas Edison of hip-hop.
Yeah, man. I mean, of course, you got Kool Herc. Everybody recognizes Kool Herc as the father of hip-hop. But to use hip-hop as a tool to stop gang violence, Afrika Bambaataa. I mean, we not gonna kill each other no more. What we gonna do is battle through breakdancing, through MCing, through DJing. We gonna create crews. And from that cruise, I'm gonna connect y'all to a lot of the stuff he talked about. I'm gonna connect you to the Nation of Islam, who speaks self-empowerment for black community. I'm gonna connect you to the 5% Nation, who speaks self-empowerment to the black community. All of this is New York saying, okay, the gang violence is too much. This dude galvanized the power of the culture of hip hop to stop gang violence. Now look at hip hop, it's happening in reverse. When you, listen, when you add something as powerful as hip hop, if you add something to that filter, it goes out all over the world. So if I love the game and I'm an African, I'm aligned with gang's blood, gang affiliation. Or if I love Lil Wayne and Lil Wayne says I'm a blood, what is a blood? Oh, it's a gang that originated in LA and they kill Crips. You see what I'm saying? And then speaking to what Africa spoke on, dude, Lil Wayne recently had a Rolling Stone interview where he says, how you gonna tell me what the fuck to do? Basically, everything I touch is successful. So it's kind of hard to tell me I'm doing drugs. That ain't a good thing to do. Wait a minute.
It depends what you use as a ruler for success.
That's the point. But what I'm saying is with spiritual guys, higher consciousness guys, such as Doc and you and me, and higher consciousness doesn't mean we're better than. It just means we're in a different space consciously. And it doesn't mean you're low. It just means you're vibrating at a different level. So,
and that frequency is lower than ours.
And there's Jeff to go ahead and push that out there. But the point that's being made is we value things that are outside of ourselves. Lil Wayne is made by his accumulation of external things, but inside, empty as a sarcophagus that has yet to bury somebody.
Whoa, say that again.
Do you understand what I'm saying? It's like you can't be made by the things that are outside of you, but we got to teach the youth that you're made by the things that are within you. So then everything you accumulate is not who you are, but a reflection of what's in you, as opposed to this makes me who I am. So
I think it's too far gone for that. I tell you what, I think it's going to have to
go deeper.
The dollar itself, the thing that they worship, is going to have to fail them. The only way that can happen is for it to fail itself. So, as soon as this dollar crashes, and all they are worth is what they are worth in fire,
mm-hmm.
then we become who we really are. They're not going to be. It's like saying, okay, how can we save the Titanic? With the half of the boat underwater.
But
we
see,
can't.
But you know what? And this goes back, all of this stuff ties in. Mitt Romney, 47%, I'm not talking about the have-nots. Those people will vote for him because they like him and because he offers governmental services. I'm not speaking to them. Listen, at the end of the day, people try to marginalize the position that this system puts on people. You cannot have rich people without defining classes of poor and middle.
That's it.
You can't have it, and you have to maintain those divisions. If everybody could be rich, it wouldn't mean anything. It wouldn't matter. So I got to keep the checks and balances in place. What are the checks and balances? I got to keep Planned Parenthood in the hood. I got to keep KFC in the hood. I got to keep liquor stores. I got to keep liquor stores in the hood. Listen, if you go to the hood and you see their grocery store versus the grocery store in your neighborhood, say you live in a nice neighborhood, Gelson's is different than Food for Less. There's a reason why Food for Less cannot buy a building in Beverly Hills. What the fuck is Food for Less doing in Beverly Hills? No, Food for Less is over there where you are because that's what we want over there. Do you understand? Beverly Hills wouldn't accept a Food for Less, now would they? Beverly
Hills. Right next to Hermes?
Yeah, you understand? Right next to Hermes, right? Right? Who's going to do that? So people don't understand. Oh, those poor people, they're just victims. Yeah, and guess what? I always say this about women and victims and black men. Black men, because we've been oppressed so tough in the American system, we figured out a way to hustle. Well, The reverse of that is women have figured a way out of hustle too. It's the same way black men have figured out a hustle. Sometimes women hustle the victim role. Because they know if I play the victim role in a patriarchal society, somebody's going to come to my rescue. Whether it's the government, that's why they have judicial gender bias, right?
Right on.
You see what I'm saying? Somebody's going to come help me if I claim lame, right? That's the same way the black man has done. I'm a claim lame, but ain't nobody come to his rescue. So what does he do? He creates jazz music. What does he do? He creates hip hop. Because he's trying to figure out a way to get out from under this oppression. So what is the symbol of success for a black man? To be able to be where the white man is. Because the white man establishes what is successful. Tell me I'm wrong. Talk to me, Dr. Mark. I threw you under
You're at warp speed. actually, once you trigger out, I think a lot of the wealthy people in the haves, they have a fear of the oppressed.
I think
the reason they have a fear of the oppressed is because, and this is a psychological term, sorry for that, there's something called projection. So I think a lot of wealthy people are afraid of the oppressed because they say to themselves, if I was that person, if I was a have-not, I'd get violent. If I was a poor, I'd be destructive because the wealthy can't stand it.
Right.
And so what they do is they need to keep the oppressed down. Part of it is because they're afraid of them. It was something we were talking about before the show is a lot of men will do that to women because there's a fear that women can see right through you as a man, that they can detect when you're BSing, they can detect when you're lying to yourself and you're lying to everyone else. And a lot of men don't detect that because they do it amongst themselves. But you look into a woman who has half a brain in her head and she's going to, and what goes on in that look is she says, I know you're full of it. You know you're full of it, and you know that I know you're full of it. And so I think a lot of times what happens is we sometimes try to keep down those people that we think can undo us. And I think some of the haves do that. There's a fear of the downtrodden because the wealthy could not stand it. They would not
themselves all the time when it happened to them.
That's what you see.
They lose all their shit and jump off a bridge.
That is right. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
But again, at the end of the day, we've got to acknowledge, because I'm tired of people, there's somewhere, it's a middle ground for everything, and everything is a half-truth. You know what I mean? Because the reason why everything is a half-truth is because most people are coming from a particular perspective. And there's multi-dimensions to every side of truth. So if I'm coming from the perspective of the poor don't need any real support. All they need is drive and go-get-itism, and then they can be where I'm at. Then that means I'm not looking at the parameters that are established. There are established borders that prevent people from getting to a certain level of success.
Can I go deeper on that?
I'm about to, and then I'm going to throw it to you, right? But take, for instance, I know this young girl who just graduated from Inglewood High School. This is the main reason why we didn't send our son to Inglewood High, right? She graduated with a 4.0, but couldn't get into UCLA, couldn't get into USC,
wow.
Couldn't get any. The best she got was Cal State Northridge. I know another girl went to John Muir High in Pasadena. Because these schools are not considered academic juggernauts, right? She had a 4.0. Couldn't get into UCLA, couldn't get into USC, couldn't get into Cal Berkeley, had the grade prerequisites, but because she couldn't get into these schools, where did she go? Grambling. Not that Grambling is bad, but how come she couldn't get into the schools that she wanted to get into? This goes back to that big to-do about Puffy Combs' son getting in on a scholarship because he's Puffy Combs' son. Not that he wasn't a good student, not that he wasn't a good athlete, but UCLA is known for not having a lot of black kids coming to that school. Once they got rid of affirmative action, they said, oh, well, we don't have to have black kids here, so we aren't going to actively get them here unless they're dunking or running a football. Come on, man. We got to talk about this systemic. You know, there's a system in place that prevents people from getting where they gotta go. People that are poor, people that have lack, people that have scarcity. There's a system in place. And maybe I'm wrong. Somebody call me and tell me if I'm wrong. 323-965-1600. Talk to me, Jeff.
This is my issue with people who say poor people need to pull up by the bootstraps. And that's the other thing. Black people, stop saying that America is racist. It's racist secondarily. It's primarily classist. If it was if it was primarily racist, there would be no Oprah, no Michael Jordan, or no wealthy black people, rich black people. There would be none of them.
Right.
So to hell with that. My issue is this. If you get up in the morning and say, poor people should be able to do exactly what I do, and I work from here or there, that's like having a race, a foot race, a 100-yard dash, and the rich guy and the poor guy are standing right there. The gun goes off. The rich guy takes off, sponsored by Nike, training in the best camps with the best food on a smooth track in lane number one. In lane number two, the poor dude has to wait. He can't take off yet.
You got to wait 17 seconds. You got to wait 17 seconds.
You got to wait 17 seconds. It's broken glass and gravel on your side. Niggas is throwing rocks at you. You got one shoe.
Sponsored by One Shoe R Us.
Yes.
Right? Right?
Yes. Sponsored by Food for Less. And the dude that gets to the finish line before you has the nerve to turn around and go, you know what? You running slow. You lazy. You unambitious. You didn't work out hard enough. You didn't want it as bad as I did. No, that's not true. And I'm not saying that that could possibly be, but if you cannot acknowledge your head start, you on some bullshit.
Well, and then go it the other way. Do it the other way. When I was in the 10th grade, my counselor told me, her name was Patsy Pentecost, Miss Pentecost, right? She,
wow.
she had a little short hair. She reminded me of Iyanla Van Zandt.
Okay.
She was like, Mr. Williams, we going to get you to Howard U. Your sister is there, and you're coming next, right? And I told her, I said, I hate school, and I hate just all of this. And she was like, no, we going to get you there, son. We going to get you there. But what she said was, to speak to your point, she said, brother, you think it's going to be easy. Well, it ain't. She said, I have to be 10 times better than Miss Sumner right next door to me just because of my skin. She said, I got to be better than her by 10 times in order to get to where she is. And we get paid the same amount. But she said, if I came in here on her level, they would have no need for me. I gotta demonstrate that I'm 10 times better than her to make the same amount of money as she makes.
Absolutely.
That's what she told me. And she said, you better get used to this world. Now, she said, now, maybe it may change when you become an adult, but right now, this is where it is. Listen, I got to take a quick break. I need to take a quick break because we're going to set up our monogamy second hour. It's coming up right now. The monogamy second hour is crazy because this ties into the 47% too. Should men or women, because I know rich women and I know rich men, should they forget about monogamy altogether because of the resources and options that are available to them? Is monogamy irrelevant to people that are rich, to people who have rich resources? Because it seems to be a problem all the way around for rich and poor people. Is monogamy the issue, especially for rich people? When I come back, we're going to get into it. 323-965-1600. 323-965-1600. Zo what? Zo mornings. We coming back. Peace. So What Morning Show. Oh my God. You know, it's kind of hot up in here. Let me just do this really quickly. I forgot to do this for the homie. DJ Mr. Number Wonderful is in the building.
That's right.
Spinning. And he's spinning all wax. This is no Serratos, no CDs. He's spinning wax. He came in here with just vinyl. Doing it. DJ Mr. Number Wonderful. Hey, really quickly. You got a website? Where people can find you. I mean, you can book this guy if you want, right? They can hit him on Facebook.
Oh, tell him.
Yeah, you can hit me on Facebook, Mr. Number Wonderful. I'm there with some SoundCloud mixes and all my events.
How do you spell Mr. Number Wonderful on the Facebook? As it said?
NUMBEROONEDERFUL.
There you go. So you just spell it all the way out. Mr. Number Wonderful. Number Wonderful. Hey, he's a dope DJ. You see the vibe. It's all chill, laid back, whatever. I love his style. He keeps it flowing for us. And again, Geoff, you on with us, right?
Yes, sir.
For anybody that's just tuning in, of course, it's the philosopher Zoe Williams, the doctor, Dr. Mark Goulston, author of Just Listen, How to Get Through to Anyone, right? I'm paraphrasing, but check out Doctor. And of course, the comedian, Geoff Brown, is on the phone with us right now at the crib in the heat. I want us to cover this topic, man, about monogamy, and I want everybody to share their opinion about it, because it seems like there's just more and more and more relationship discord, and people seem to be surprised or shocked about it when something happens in the news, whether it's Chad and Evelyn, whether it's Usher and what's her name, Tamika. I mean, people seem to be surprised about it. And there's to me, there's this heavy cloud of judgment, as if, oh, man, you're a terrible person because you've gone through this. And I'm just saying, in my understanding, relationship conflict is ubiquitous in relationships. And not only is it ubiquitous, but we have the wrong mentality for it. We think it's bad, and it might be bad in feeling, but the opportunity that it presents for growth, to me, is incredible. But I'm wondering, is our ideation and our concept of monogamy, is that the problem that creates a lot of rift in the relationship?
I think the problem is that we're in a culture or time of not getting your way is wrong, is bad. Mm. Not getting your way actually makes you stronger, but no one wants to go down that road. Mm. And so not getting your way seems to be the enemy. And the more that you have money and the more that you have people adoring you outside in the world, and you come home and you're just a regular person who's late with a lot of things, with your family, with paying bills, not getting your way, people seem to have this attitude, well, I don't have to tolerate that.
So it's kind of the era of instant gratification, and you're not good or useful to me if you can't gratify me now.
I think you can translate the whole monogamy thing into people, you know, not getting their way. Well, you know, I'm a little bit bored. I want a little bit more excitement, and I'm not getting my way if I don't feel that at home, so I'm just going to go somewhere else. And God wouldn't have given me all these impulses if he didn't want me to gratify them.
Wow.
I think until you see the benefit of not getting your way to actually help you, it actually helps you get closer to the other person, as long as you don't get violent and hostile and beat up on them. I mean, you need a breakdown to have a breakthrough to get closer, but a lot of people won't go there.
You need a breakdown to have a breakthrough.
Come on now.
But so many people are afraid of the breakdown because it requires vulnerability. And if I'm vulnerable in that moment, I feel like I will always be a victim. I feel like I will always be taken advantage of, but they don't realize the advantage of the breakdown. It leads to the breakthrough.
I think the single most important lesson I've learned in life is that I've probably had, I'd say, 200 breakthroughs in my life, and they were all preceded by breakdowns, and none of the breakdowns were invited. None of them felt good. Some of them felt pretty awful. And so the one thing that I have learned when I am experiencing breakdown, where my thinking, my feelings, my actions are out of sync with everything, I say to myself, don't do anything to make it worse for 48 hours. Because what will happen is... And if I can do that, I often have a breakthrough. But if you do things to make it worse, what happens is you then have to hide what you did that made it worse. Yeah, because you're embarrassed and you don't want it to be found out by other people. You don't want it to be found out by your conscience.
It's a loss of control.
Right. And so what happens is you miss out on the breakthrough because the way you dealt with the breakdown, you know, you made things worse and now you have to deal with that. But if you can just... when you know you're having one, if you can say to yourself, don't do anything to make it worse for 48 hours, and you will have more breakthroughs. And sometimes the breakthrough has nothing to do with the breakdown, But that's what I say to myself whenever I'm feeling out of sorts and things aren't working. I say, don't do anything to make this worse for 48 hours.
Geoff Brown, go deep.
Nobody of a younger generation, I'll say, nobody under 40 is comfortable with taking an L or sacrificing themselves for anything, for what I want to eat for dinner, let alone for my family. The concept of, you know what, I might not get what I want this time. No, that's bullshit. I'm getting what I want every time. And if you both are going to take that road, that's a recipe for disaster, especially in a marriage. Now, in my opinion, I think monogamy is becoming outdated. I think that monogamy, and this is coming from a happily married dude that does not cheat on his wife, but I don't understand where it's getting old. It's
okay. If you can't be monogamous, don't have kids.
That's it.
Because your kids are watching you. Your kids are watching how you interact with each other. And your kids, there's a saying, kids never listen to their parents, but they never fail to grow up and imitate them.
Ooh.
And so kids are, when they look at the way you and your spouse have conflict and whether you deal with it, they are like, their little brains are like watching, eating popcorn and saying, well, let's see how conflict gets dealt with in my family. And when they see a coldly logical person beat up on an emotional person or emotional person beat up in a coldly logical person, right, they're just watching. And that's why so many kids don't feel centered, because they watch these zero-sum, scorched-earth conflicts between their parents.
And I believe this is how generational curses are passed on.
Through programming.
You think you can talk to your kid and lead them the right way. No, your kid is learning through your life, from your how you live, not just what you say, because believe me, children are exceedingly intelligent and they can see the contradiction between what you say and how you behave.
Kids get more of their center and their calmness from how much their parents like each other.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I hate to say that. I know it's cold. I mean, you know,
wow.
I've been married many years and, you know, we love each other, but a lot of times we don't like each other. But I think when kids see, oh my God, they're not liking each other, creates tension in the kids. The kids think something is going to explode.
Well, Doc,
and they don't know what it is.
I need some, I'm going to get personal right here. I need some help. And I don't know how damn funny this is going to turn out, but I actually experienced firsthand what you were discussing less than 48 hours ago when I dropped my children off. My house is happy. It's peaceful. My wife now and I don't handle conflict with the raising of voices, and believe me, shit hits the fan over here. But we just don't handle it like that. When I dropped my kids off, 30 seconds before they saw their mother's face, they were laughing and playing. As soon as they, and I'm not going to say it's her, I know they love her, but as soon as they were in the atmosphere, in the soup of the mix of me and her, and that tense shit right there, I could feel their unhappiness hit me like a rock.
Wow.
And I want to say it's enough for me to swallow the dreadfully unforgivable things that I feel that she has done. But it's hard, Doc. It's, oh my God.
So let the doc address it.
Okay, you know, also to make it even harder on all of us, I'm just telling you the truth as I've seen it. It's not bad that kids see their parents having conflict. What really discourages kids is conflicts that never get resolved. People are going to have differences of opinions. They're going to have fights. But when you say, oh my God, they're fighting over the same thing for the 100th time, if it's not going to work out, just why don't you just break up and try and be happy somewhere else? It's watching conflicts that never get resolved. You're always going to have conflict, but that's what discourages a lot of kids. And I think a lot of kids, by the way, start to turn to drugs. They try and drown it out because they can't quiet how bad it feels inside themselves.
Well, and let's go into it a little more. When we're talking about, you know, the conflicts that happen in relationship, do you think conflict leads to infidelity? Or do you think infidelity is just part of the human nature?
I think conflict leads to resentment, leads to rage, leads to entitlement that I don't need to stand for this. And I actually, and if I get even, it's because the other person drove me to it. I think what conflict does is
which is non-accountability.
Yeah, it pushes us.
Look, yes.
It pushes us into our immaturity. I mean, something I said earlier is I think it's true that there's no such thing as human nature. There's just animal nature, but you don't have to give in to it. But we all give in to it, and what's happening is it's getting kind of glorified. Well, everybody can give in to it, but if you give in to everything you want, and that's in conflict with what the other person wants, you know, then it's just going to be chaos.
Right, and you know, Iyanla Van Zandt has a new television show that's on the Oprah Winfrey Network, the OWN Network. It's called Fix Your Life, and I really look at what we do on this show as the male counterpoint to that. Because I believe that men need help. I mean, Chad Ochocinco needs help, just like Chris Brown needs help. And a lot of times in American society, I think we look at the woman as the automatic default victim in a situation where there's conflict, especially in a public forum, the way their relationship was. Men have to stand behind men and support men who also fail and falter. I've failed and faltered many times. Fortunately, I met Mark. Mark is like, hey, I got your support here. I see where you are. Let me support you in that. Geoff Brown has done the same for me as well. I've done the same for other men. I think we have to utilize this platform, right, for men, for women, whoever wants to call in and get a male perspective, because there are spiritually conscious men out there who want to help other people, just like there's an Iyanla Van Zandt, you know.
I hit a low point in my life many, many years ago, and maybe another show we'll talk about that. But and I was just speaking to a reverend in one of the biggest churches in New York, and what I realized is this man, there was a man who stepped in, who turned everything around, and I realized as I was speaking to this Reverend Jim
Jones.
Jim
Jones?
No. Jim, I think it's God. He's the main reverend at the Saint John the Divine Cathedral in New York. But what I realized is that this person who stepped in when I was at kind of a dark point. He was an angel. I mean, I didn't know. I don't mean the word. I mean, he was an angel.
Absolutely.
And what I realized is he stood up for me when I couldn't. He stood by me and wouldn't let me fail. He believed in me. And that gave him the right to stand up to me and stop me from doing stupid stuff.
Wow.
And so I've been trying to pay that forward ever since. But if you can think about anyone who stood up for you, stood by you, and then you allow them to stand up to you, and you just keep paying that forward.
Right, right.
It will all make the world, you know, much better. And I think it's the standing, that's what we're talking about, is standing up to someone. I see a lot of people who have acted on impulses, and then they don't want to, but they feel weak. And so what I try to do is stand up for them and buy them to themselves, and then I stand up to them and I say, you're not going to do that. And we get into an argument, but I don't get angry. I say, you're not going to do that. And we'll go about 15 rounds, and then if we're fortunate and I don't get angry and I'm just firm, they crack, they cry, and they say, but I can't not do it. I'm weak. I said, you're not weak. You're just not going to do that. You're just human.
I think this is a great place for me to make a sweeping male-female generalization that will start a firestorm.
Here we go.
But the one thing that upsets me about women, I would say over everything.
Wait. 323-965-1600. Go.
is with men, I don't know one dude, Zoe, myself, I'm just talking about cats I respect, you, Doc, certain comedians I respect that will ever, ever circle the wagons around shitty dudes. Dudes that don't care for kids. Dudes that beat women. Dudes that sell drugs. All them dudes on their bullshit.
Okay, I see what you're saying. His phone is breaking up a little bit. What he's saying is, you don't see a bunch of men in support of no good men.
Thank you.
Whether it's, you know, whether they're not taking, hey, that's a good job. You should ignore that dude. But that dude is your son. No, you don't see a bunch of brothers that are, or men in general, that support other men. But what I will say Geoff, is you see a lot of men acquiesce. We might not be in support of, but we don't step in and say, nah, homie, that ain't right.
Now, one of the reasons we get afraid to step in, one of the reasons we don't confront other people, it's we might say, oh, I don't want to hurt their feelings. I don't want to upset them. Really, what we're afraid of is that we will trigger something in them. They will then be provoked, and they will push us into our rage, and we will lose control. So superficially, it's like, oh, I don't want to say this to the person because it'll upset them or hurt them. But I think what we're really afraid of is
well, I don't want to lose
if
control.
If they're
right?
wounded and they come back at us, that they will push us into a part of ourselves that we feel could go out of control and off the deep end.
Right. So that brings us back to the point that we brought up earlier about monogamy, especially with men and women of means. Why should I get into a long-term relationship with somebody that's going to have me constantly managing myself so that I don't lose my cool, right? Because relationships have a lot of demands just inherently. We're together, that means I have to be considerate. Well, no, I don't. Not if I'm just seeing you.
Maybe the thing is, I think if you just get clear with what you've agreed upon instead of BSing each other. I remember a friend of mine in a company said, you know, our values on our website is that we care about our customers and clients, but really what we practice is we want to sell them anything that they'll buy and by any means possible. And he said, I think all we need to do is maybe we won't put it on our website, but I think we should go by those values that we don't care about anything other than selling our customers and clients whatever we can cram down their throat. Then at least we're not hypocrites. So what if couples came together of means and said, well, I think we hope it works, but, if we're feeling cheated or deprived of something else, I think each of us are just going to go out and do whatever we can to get our needs met. And why don't we just say that up front to
right.
begin with and,
but you
and
know
just
what?
Be honest?
That's a good point. Geoff, you know what else?
What's up?
And I want you to speak on this, too. I think the doc touched on something underneath that. I think that's all we're doing is selling and buying each other's bullshit.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's what's... We're never really at the deeper levels. It's always selling and buying the prepared, manicured image of who we want this person to think we really are. And I think it's coming from men, but it's also coming from women, too. Because when I speak to women, they will tell you, in alphabetical order, all of the stuff they saw in the beginning up to the point that they couldn't take it anymore, all of the little things that you did, and they just filed it. And my point is, why did you wait so long if you had all of these hints that spoke to you?
Because one of the reasons people don't blow the whistle early is because they get attached to the future.
Ooh.
And the future, and what happens is when you start thinking that future is not going to happen and you don't have a backup plan, you start to lie to yourself.
And on that note, book request, go get The Power of Now. Because so many, by Eckhart Tolle, so many people have ruined their relationships because they couldn't be present. They couldn't be in the moment. They couldn't accept things for the what is of it, for the now of it. They're always trying to invest in the future, and they wind up tricking off the present. Geoff Brown, go deeper.
Oh, man, that is just so right on with everything that I have been through. I mean, the purposely ignoring shit that was right there. When I had a girl that our relationship went to hell, and everything that I didn't like about her was right there on the first date, and I could not see it until I looked back.
Wow.
Couldn't see it until I looked when I got to her house, she was in the process on the phone of ending a relationship with a friend at 110 decibels.
Wow.
And I still went out with her. We got into the restaurant. There were, and it was a nice restaurant. Everything was moderately to expensively priced. This heifer didn't have one thing that wasn't expensive. Not one thing. It was like she set out to make sure that her shit to eat cost more than mine. I saw all this. I saw every bit of it. And all of those.
Well, let me ask you a quick question, Geoff. Did you have sex with her yet before this happened?
I had not had sex with her.
Is that why you? That was the future projection.
It was. I was married to waxing that ass. I was going. I had set my sights on jacking up her hair. It wasn't even a. I want the sex to be so off the chain that her hair sweats out. She goes to sleep, and I have to wake her up. If that does not happen, I have miserably failed.
No, okay.
That's where I was. So I was, I'm going to tear off. Oh, my God. And you know what I should have done? I should have done exactly that and left that heifer alone.
Well, let me do this really quickly because we have a guest who's here in the building with us. You know her, Geoff. She wrote a question. She probably doesn't want me to say her name, but I will. It's kind of what I do. I just throw people under the bus. She's a Hollywood insider. You know her. She doesn't want me to say her name. I'll just give you her initials, LJ.
What? That's my girl. I know exactly who that is.
She's in the building right now.
Hey, crazy girl, what's up?
She doesn't have a microphone. She's waving. She wrote a question. She said, some men ask for a woman to support their dreams and goals. When done, some women feel at the end of the journey or at the end of the journey after they've been exhausted or, you know, I guess defeat is imminent. She's basically saying, is the journey the lesson or the beginning of bitterness? I think that's what you're saying. Is that what you're saying? Yes. She's saying, after all I've invested, and it doesn't seem like my investment is going to pay off. At the end of the journey, is this where the bitterness starts?
It's a question to me.
This is Geoff, you, the doc, me. We all going to chime in.
Okay. In my opinion, that's a case-by-case basis. If the individual...
I disagree. I'm sorry, Geoff. I disagree.
In my opinion, I can't say. How can you say... necessarily, yes. The easy answer is yes. But what is it? Let me hit this back over the net this way.
But see, this is why I always tell women, don't date an idea or an agenda.
Thank you.
And women are dating ideas and agendas that are socially constructed. You can't... Listen, there's a wonderful book out there called Guilt is the Teacher, Love is the Lesson by Dr. Joan Borisenko, PhD. Get it. Because what happens is, she says, most women and most people are sufferers of conditional love. The time where there are the least conditions is when the child comes. Because that's when you love the child, win or lose. You know, I try to give you whatever philosophy. If you win or lose, it doesn't matter. You're still my baby. I love you. But we have all of these principles, concepts, ideas, and standards. Oh, I can't date beneath my standards. Your standards sometimes are more important than the person you're with.
Absolutely.
And the standards become concretized and are never challenged for weaknesses. A lot of people don't understand.
So
it is the belief.
What was your question again, Zowat? Because we need to address her question.
No, but what I'm saying is, I believe sometimes, because she's talking about at the end of the journey, this is where bitterness begins.
Define it.
And I'm saying in conjunction, well, the end of the relationship for her.
Okay.
So I'm saying in conjunction with what the doc said about that future forecast, a lot of people are putting all of this energy and effort for that future thing to manifest itself as if the future has the answer for your relationship.
I think the journey ends earlier when you're feeling hurt and disappointed and you won't admit it to yourself.
Wow.
So you're paying into this thing and something in your gut tells you it just ain't right and I'm not going to get this back, but you don't want to think about it because it hurts too much, it's too disappointing, it's too painful, and then you just keep investing into it. You know, a lot of times when people feel really most disappointed and hurt by someone, you know what they do? They give the other person more.
Wow.
They give them more because they don't want to feel how upset it is.
Wow.
And then they keep hoping for something. One of the things that I've learned in the last few years is I identify people as either takers, givers, or traders, T-R-A-D-E-R-S. And what I realized, so I just try to find givers now in my life, because you give to them and they give back. They don't keep score. It's and you should fill your life with that.
But, wow. I got something for you.
Okay, but I think what she was talking about is she was involved with a taker.
But she
didn't want to admit it to herself.
I don't know if it's that clear cut. You know, I just believe that you have people who claim to be givers, the wolf in sheep's clothing kind of situation, where they claim to be givers, but they're actually takers.
Absolutely.
You know, and I believe maybe you'll have a person who gives, and gives to bait you into believing that they're a giver, so that they can then switch the tables, you know, passive aggressively, and come across as if, you know, now it's time for you to give because I've given so much. You understand what I'm saying? Like, there's a victimhood attached to the giver, to me, to some degree. And maybe you can help me with that. We got to take a quick break, but when we come back, more on the monogamy thing. Is it even relevant? Should we just start? Should we create a contract that, like a football player? I heard somebody say this before. A football player contract where you say, okay, we're going to do this thing for 3 years, and then the fourth year is optional. We'll review the whole thing after 3 years, and if it ain't cool, we're out of here. We won't re-sign for the fourth year. Maybe it should be that way. 323-965-1600. We'll be back in 2.2 Zo What Mornings. Holla.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. 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 Yeah, yeah, yeah. 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 Mm, mm,
mm. Yeah, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Zo What Mornings, with Geoff Brown, Zo Williams, and Dr. Mark Goulston. We're talking about monogamy. Is it even relevant anymore, man? A lot of people look at Tiger Woods and say, man, he's a billionaire. He shouldn't have got married. And then we listen to Usher, who just went through it with Tamika, you know, going through divorce, going through, you know, custody battles, and he explained, I just thought it was the right thing to do. How many of us are socially behaving? Like, I got to do the socially right thing to do, but not doing the spiritually correct thing to do for themselves. Just because society says it's a good idea, maybe it's not a good idea. I mean, you know, it's so fragmented. It's like, oh, I want to do the right thing according to the Bible. Let's just say it's the Bible. According to the Bible, I want to do the right thing. I don't want to bring a child out of wedlock into the world. Well, weren't you fornicating in the first place? So fornication is cool, but bringing a child in out of wedlock isn't cool. And if you're married, does that make you a better parent? You know what I'm saying? These are, you know, what if you're a great parent, but you're not married? What if you have two great parents that never married, but raised you right? Are you still illegitimate? Are you somehow a bastard because you guys didn't get married? Do you understand how we interfaced ideologically and we never challenged the ideas? What if you got two great parents that didn't get married but raised a great child? Oh, that would be President Obama. How about that?
No, as long as what people say and do matches the way you feel about them. I think when you see people and you hear them say things, and something in your gut says something isn't wrong, what it does is it attacks your ability to believe whoever the person is. So I think you can have two parents who it didn't work out or they never got married, but if the way they interact with you and each other is what you see and what you hear matches what you feel in your gut, then you can sort of relax and you actually feel like you belong somewhere. But when what you see and what you hear doesn't match what you feel inside, you can't relax. And that's why a lot of people carry around this hole in their stomach and their hole in their being and don't feel very centered. And then that's when they start reaching for these external things to spackle the hole in their being, when really what they need to do is find a way to trust, even though everything inside them tells them they shouldn't.
Wow. Nobody can trust. I'm sorry. Trust is so high and rare. It's like love. We got Diet Cola love. Everybody's got aspartame in their love. I'm sorry.
But we did have one issue. We did have one issue, you know, that I wanted to address from one of our friends here, which is what happens when you support a partner to go after their dreams and then the dream doesn't happen. What happens is, I think part of it is, there's a point at which you, when you're talking to a spouse and you don't want to rain on their parade, especially a woman doesn't want to rain on the man's dream, you got to have a conversation about what's reasonable and what's realistic. And what's realistic is what's likely to happen. That's what we have to live with. It may be reasonable to think I'm going to do all these wonderful things, but it may not be realistic. And one of the things that I suggest to people, always when, if possible, focus on the future that no one's messed up, as opposed to when something's happened. When something's happened, nobody listens to anybody. And what does that mean? So when you're with someone, what you might say is, going forward, in the event that this doesn't work out for you, and you may need someone to step in and gently tell you it's not going to work out for you, what's the best way to approach you? So, you know, so it's as least hurtful as possible. So when you throw a dart into the future, nothing's messed up. And if the person says, well, never tell me anything is wrong at all, never tell me that I'm wrong about anything, or never rain on my parade, well, then you got to think to yourself, I am dealing with one heck of an immature person here.
But that's what and Geoff, maybe you can help me with this. I believe the majority of people are emotionally immature to have that kind of conversation. To me, that's a conversation for a high level of consciousness, to come in and really try to position the conversation to try and help someone. You understand what I'm saying? And then they receive what you're bringing. I think most times the way that is received is argumentative.
If you'd like to make a call, please hang up
or
and try.
Combatively, you know? I just feel that way. I think we have a caller on, too. It's Geoff. Okay. You know, I mean, somebody tell me different. Doc, what do you think?
I think it's better to show than to tell. So we have a good relationship. It's mm-hmm. building. It's going well. I think there's mutual respect. Going forward, in the event that I see you doing something that's just going to go south,
right?
That's only going to hurt you,
right?
And you're not going to want to like. You're not going to like what I have to tell you. But as your friend, I need to tell you. Going forward, what's the best way to bring that up to you?
For me,
yeah,
I would just say, because I think I'm a competitive person, mm-hmm. and I think I'm combative
mm-hmm.
and stubborn. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you bring it to me in a respectful way, you know, and the way it's worded, and I tell my children this, the way it's worded is, I said, I don't mind if you disagree, just don't do it disrespectfully.
Mm-hmm.
You can disagree with me all day in the world, you know, all day long. But if you do it disrespectfully, that's when I close off. So if Mark comes to me and say, I have to challenge you on something, Zoe, you got to do it respectfully. And then I'm open and receptive to everything. I think that's a great question for Geoff as well. Geoff, how would I bring it to you?
Well, I have very thick skin, especially as a stand-up. And nothing offends me more than an individual who plays to my feelings when they have my goodwill in their other hand.
Oh.
Say more about that. That's profound.
If you got, because that's the way I handle things. If I love you personally, and I'm growing to love you, Doc. We just met. Don't rush things. I love Zoe. Zoe is my.
You just love my ignorant white question of the day. I know that.
But I got to grow. I got to know you more. I'm gonna get to love you. It takes a little time because I'm kind of crusty. I love Zoe. If I see Zoe doing something that I think is detrimental, the difference between me and you is I'm not going to ask Zoe about his feelings. I'm going to hit him up. Nigga, that's horrible.
Right.
Straight up. I love you, and you don't have to like what I'm saying, but it's against my man code to think it and not say it to you. And I'm not going to say it to other people. I'm not going to go chit-chat behind your back about you to them. I'm going to tell you, Zoe, dude, you cannot live on 40 ounces and tricks. You have to do better than this.
Yeah, but Geoff, what you were saying, and I wouldn't ask him about his feelings, because what you did is, when the other person knows you care about them, you can leverage that. I could say to Zoe without feelings, we've earned the right, and I could probably say that to you, you know this thing you're doing? Stop it.
Yeah, you could.
Just stop it, because it's only going to hurt you. And if you say it non-judgmentally, but out of wanting to help them, that makes a world of difference.
And I think that's a great point right there. Non-judgmental communication. There's a book out there called Non-Violent Communication. I forget the author, but if you go to Amazon.com, you look up Non-Violent Communication. Trust me. You know, it's an excellent book, and I have it. I haven't mastered it. I haven't mastered any of the things I talk about on this show.
You know? I don't think that's the license to talk about them. That's the other
right.
thing that pisses
and
off with people.
Exactly.
When you hear, well, fool, you don't know me. You don't know. Do I have to? Is that a prerequisite for this
no,
course?
I don't trust experts. I think the more that you're in the struggle and you don't give up, that makes you a true true expert. It's if sometimes when you talk like you're an expert know-it-all, you don't know anything. I think being in the struggle but refusing to give up and have it drag you down, I think that's what that gives you the most strength to help someone else.
Wow. I trust truth.
Exactly.
I trust truth, and I don't give a shit where it comes from.
Okay.
I've heard brilliant
come from bums and crackheads. And if you are going to pre-qualify what I believe the Creator's message is to you just because of where it came from, then that means those of you Bible bumpers who love Jesus, most of you would have ignored Jesus because of how he rolled up.
Okay, let me just do this really quickly, Geoff, because we have an irritant in the studio right now. We only have, you know, 2 or 3 minutes, and I'm just going to do it. She said male ego and destruction. She's basically saying the male ego cuts up or lashes out when they don't get what they want. Let me just say, the male ego is a cold piece of work.
That's true.
But the ego isn't just male specific. The female ego is cold, too.
Yeah, women don't.
Come on now.
Women don't? Really? Women don't? To say that isolates women, like, that's some shit men do. Like saying, you know what, generally, unless it's real early in the morning, men stand up when they pee.
Listen, the wandering eye is a product of female ego. When you're with your woman, why is she focused on your eyes and who you're looking at? It's her female ego in play. You're
Thank
with
you,
me,
sir.
Pimp.
Thank you.
Keep those peepers now, over here.
Now that I'm rolling with a certified dime, she don't give a damn where I'm looking
okay,
at.
Okay, listen, listen. We got to, hey, Geoff, we got to wrap. We got 20 seconds to do it.
Crap.
Ah, God. We got to finish this next week. I'm sorry. Geoff Brown, international comedian. Appreciate you being on.
Thank
tell him real quick. Twitter real quick. What is it?
GB Funny Style, and catch me on Facebook, Brown Funny Style.
There it is. And Dr. Mark Goulston, where can they find you really quickly?
MarkGoulston.com, MarkGoulston.com. Sign up and get some of these outrageous tips.
Hey, at Zoe Williams on Twitter, the VOR at Zoe Williams on Twitter. And I'm about to put up a new website called IamZoeWilliams.com where we're going to release an excerpt of chapter 1 from my relationship book, The Relationship Dismount, How to Break Up and Let Go.
Whoa, it's crazy.
It's about to be on and cracking. Trust me. See you next week. It's going to be cool. I'll holler at you then.
Music, like other art forms, is a means of articulating concepts, viewpoints, and emotions that are not easily verbalized.
Oh boy, is this exciting!
We are going to rehearse a rhythm which we can play with a different kind of song. So, let's start.
If you'd like to make a call, please hang up and try again. If you need help, hang up and then dial your operator. If you'd like to make a call, please hang up and try again. If you need help, hang up and then dial your operator. If you'd like to... Yeah.